has mercy and rain down the cleansing flood, healing waters rise around us, and hear our cries, Lord, let them rise. God's mercy and rain down the cleansing flood, healing waters rise around us, and hear our cries, Lord, let them rise. And it's your kindness, Lord, that leads to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire. It's your beauty, Lord, that makes us stand in silence. And your love is better than life. Cries, Lord, let them rise.
Good morning and welcome once again to this Sunday, the 30th of August, where we come before the Lord in worship and thanksgiving, praising Him in all things. And remember, wherever we are at, we have one God who is with us at all times, and we worship Him really in unison together. So God bless you. I hope you're doing okay on this day that we celebrate the Lord and worship Him. Hope things are going well in your home. I hope you're keeping your distance from one another in the right way and are staying safe and away from this virus. And we know that God, throughout all things, is going to be faithful to us. God is faithful all the time, friends, and we are coming before Him in thanksgiving today. continue on this series of messages that we'll get to in just a moment about the fruit of the Spirit. Today's theme is going to be kindness. And I enjoy this theme. I think there's what the world could use much more of is a bit more of kindness towards one another. And a reminder of that is of where the basis, and that's where, of all the fruit of the Spirit messages, I want to make sure that we have the emphasis placed on the foundation or the reality or the place where we should go to first and foremost, and that's the Lord. And Psalm 145, verse 17 reminds us of that the Lord, He is righteous, which means He is right in all things, but He's also the place to look to. He is the place and the one to look to in all things because His ways are the right ways, the righteous ways. And He's righteous in all His ways. And the other side of God, and this is maybe what we don't think of God nearly enough. I think too many want to think of God as a punishing God, a vengeful God, and a God who's really not for me in the right ways. And He truly is, and He is kind. Friends, He is kind in all things, kind in all His deeds. And I am thankful of that. His grace is the foundation of that for each of us because whatever we get, whatever we have, we don't deserve, yet it is granted to us because all things belong to Him. We are God's creation. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Remember that. And it's in God's hands. And He chooses, that's the thing, He chooses to be kind to us. And kindness for us then should be a choice. That's a way I want to start this off today, that we have to choose to be kind to one another for it to be completely ingrained in our spirit. But let's take a break from that for just a moment. We'll get back to that. Some announcements, just a couple of brief ones. We will continue to have our Tuesday meals, evening meals from approximately 4 to 5 p.m. And we're so grateful and so blessed of the kindness that is given in so many ways, either people bringing money to support these meals, or people delivering meals, people preparing the meals, and then we get to feel the effects when we get to enjoy the meals. And this week, it's one of my favorites. It's a pulled pork sandwich. Keith Kenny smokes the pork for us, and then the additives are given to it, and we'll have a pulled pork sandwich with chips that will be your meal this Tuesday evening. This past Wednesday, we had the privilege of serving the youth home once again. I believe during the pandemic, it's at least the third time we have done that. And Teresa and I took the meal over there Wednesday night for the crew. And remember, these kids are pretty well separated from their families and from others. And we hit the right day when we took it on Wednesday because one of the kids who are living there right now, it was her 16th birthday. And so she was thrilled to going to have a meal from O'Charlie's. That's where we got the food. So it was a good evening to take that. And they're so pleased and so blessed by us doing that. And we're going to try to continue doing that as long as they want us to. And we've had a couple of people help to sponsor that with cash donations. And these are, you know, some usually approximately 15 youth that are at risk or in there for some particular reason, and they're offering kindness and mercy and help towards those teenagers while they had their stay there at the youth home, and hopefully then to get them back on the right track, whether it's with their school, whether it's with their home and family life, or any type of relational problem they might be incurring. Now, next week, this is the exciting part for me. You won't have to. If you choose not to, you'll have this option, but to have worship online. But next week, we return to in-person worship on the first Sunday in September. I'm looking forward to that. Once again, our chairs are continue to be scattered, separated from one another. We'll have our social distance. We will come together, worship the Lord. Remember, we choose not to have too many songs during that time, just because that's one opportunity where, you know, we can. It offers more opportunity, I guess, for our germs to get out amongst one another. So we'll wear our masks while you're in the actually, when you come in the building, we request that you put your mask on, and especially in the sanctuary where we gather together in a large space. But I know there's a few folks that the masks are a problem, and I understand that. I know that can happen. And next Sunday is an important, if you're looking at the screen right now, You'll see another announcement about that Sunday. I believe the date is the 6th. It's the Sunday before Labor Day. I'll choose to say the Holy Communion is the most important time about that Sunday, but also we will have an important vote for the church that day on the decision which has come recommended by Ag Council to sell the parsonage that's on Clifton Drive. A lot of work has been done to that parsonage just to basically spruce it up and make it ready for whatever is next. And whatever is in your hands. And we will take a vote on it immediately following worship. We'll have a church conference. It's a church-wide conference where membership has the opportunity to vote, and you must be here to vote. And so I know the masks are a problem, and we want to try to offer the opportunity for everybody to be here. So on that Sunday, throughout the worship time and the time of the vote, and we'll offer this each Sunday, if the masks are a problem, please wear it in the public spaces, the hallway, restrooms, wherever you might be out in the public areas. But then we're going to offer the conference room, which we have the sound and the video. We have the TV in there that can show that what's going on in the worship center. And you can go in there, keep social distance from one another, except for whoever you might, maybe a spouse or someone you're coming with, and you can stay in there without the mask. And so that does offer an opportunity for you to be in that space and still be here, especially for that critical vote on that Sunday morning, which will take place at 11:30. Randy Anderson, who is our associate conference superintendent, will be here to lead that session. It's not led by me, and it is by Randy. And it shouldn't take that long. If questions need to be asked, of course, the opportunity will be there for you to ask those, to get answers. I would urge you to either stop by on Clifton Drive or seek out someone, trustees or Ad Council, that might be able to offer you some suggestions or answer your questions. That might be some like John Swope, Victor Doty, Keith Kenney, any of those folks who have been directly affected by that. And then there's been a lot of hands on deck, so to speak, over there at that house to help. And I certainly want to express my thankfulness to all those who have put in so many, it's almost now we can count it in days, not hours, as the time that has been spent over there. So that vote, important, please try to be here. It won't be a raised hand ballot, it will be a paper ballot. So, it will be, no one will know how you place your vote. Okay. That's coming up. We're going to offer a prayer for that this morning for the Lord to guide us in that too. Remember, your giving, faithfulness in giving is so critical. Faithfulness in attending is critical, of course, at the right times, but also giving can be done in any way at any time. And I know many of you have dropped off. We've had some giving from other sources even come in towards our church, and we're so thankful that we have had that. Prayer. I know during this time, prayer has been important to you. I know you're praying for many things. This past week, we've had some emergencies come up once again that cause us to pause and go to the Lord, one being the shooting in Kenosha. I think that actually was last Sunday that took place. And it's caused a lot more rioting, a lot more unrest. And then the hurricanes that have come up through the Gulf Coast and also gotten rain here in our area from that. But many people have been in harm's way for any of those situations. And we want to come before the Lord now and pray about all those things. Will you bow with me this morning? God of mercy, God of grace, God of love, God of peace. And as the psalm said this morning, God who is so kind to us in all times and all places. Lord, we seek you with us. Your Spirit enables us to have this connection that is so vital, so rich, so important as we go through our day-to-day journey. And the unrest of this past week, whether it be through another unrest in the streets or through political conventions that have gone over the past 2 weeks, or whether it's through the natural realm, such as the hurricanes, Lord, we've had our share of that once again. So, Lord, calm our fears. Place within us that holy desire to seek you first and be reminded of how present you are in all situations. for protection, for guidance, for help, for peace in the midst of these storms of whatever proportion or creation or reality that they really are. And there's even storms in our daily life with impact from the economy, from all these things, and just the upsetting nature. You know, even going back to school right now has been upsetting in a lot of ways. We pray for continue to lift up our schools and universities to offer the safest and the best possible environment so that learning and teaching might take place. And not just the students are kept safe, but all, especially those bus drivers and school workers and cafeteria workers and teachers and administrators and all who are there for the benefit of our education system. And God be with them and give them the right way to teach and to be about our students. Lord, lead us and personally in our own journeys of faith and our own journeys of hope and concern and even lead us to a greater kindness toward one another. And Lord, may the theme and the words from Scripture rest upon our hearts on this day that you have provided for us. Lord, we lift up those, especially in our own flock, who stand in need of your help and your mercy and in some ways a gentle nudge or a healing that might need to take place in their lives. And Lord, we know you're a powerful and present God, and we place each one of those persons whom we love in your hands for the care that they might need. Lord, give thanks. We bless you this morning. We worship you and we glorify you and all that we say. And we come together this morning to even unite our voices in the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, Lord, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for that time of being with you. We continue on this journey of plowing the field, cultivating the Spirit. And I was just reminded once again as I think about cultivating the Spirit. Have you looked around lately? And we've been so blessed this summer with a lot of moisture and good temperatures for the most part. Wow, we've had some heat and humidity, but seems to have made the crops grow quite well. Those fields were cultivated. They were prepared. The soil was rich. The Lord sent the rain. The Lord sent the right additives. And now the crop looks like it's going to overflow the bins. Now, whether or not the results the farmers get from their because of prices, you know, that's another matter. But because the right work was put into it and all the right ingredients happened at the right time, there's going to be a great harvest and yielding great fruit. Today, the fruit of the Spirit is driven by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit working within, too, which is for each of us the right additive for us to have to make us, to will within us. I want to say this, I know it's God's nature to example the fruit of the Spirit for each of us, the love, the joy, the peace, the patience, the kindness, the goodness, on down the road to self-control. But is it my nature? Is it our nature? We're so tempted to be given into sin that our nature sometimes can pull us not to be kind, to be impatient, to be not as loving as we should be, to not be there to offer the kind word, to maybe be a word of gossip or criticism at sometimes. So we have to have the attitude, the right attitude of the Holy Spirit to look to guide us in all these things. Just like this water is water in this pot to make the flower grow, which is, you know, I love flowers. My flowers in my flower garden right now just bloomed beautifully all summer. And to me, it's kind of like a heart. It's an example of God's love towards me as I can walk out my door and enjoy what God has given to me. Now, I want to be able to walk out my door and encounter one another and have them enjoy my presence because I have exampled have someone enjoy my presence because I have cultivated, I have allowed the Holy Spirit to work within me to will and act according to His good pleasure. And I'll continue to talk about that as I go through over the next couple of weeks, because when we look in the mirror, I want to go back to this. It says, growing in Christ likeness. When we look in the mirror, it's not like, you know, you're going to see this, whatever picture you have of Jesus, that you look like Him. It's that you example Him to another. I think sometimes we put too much pressure on ourselves to be a little Jesus in this world. It's not going to happen. You're not going to be a little Jesus, but you will be, maybe you'll example Jesus' love or Jesus' presence towards one another by what you say and do. And boy, sometimes I think as I get older, that's one of the things I'm reminded of, is when I don't example Jesus to one another, this flooding of guilt becomes to come over me, and I know I got to come to the Lord and ask for forgiveness. But here's what, again, I know I give you these verses every week, so maybe you've begun to memorize these by now, but the Holy Spirit, remember, it produces all these things. It's not something that you're doing on your own. Don't put the pressure on yourselves to say, I got to do this. I got to be this person. If you're allowing through prayer and through, you know, through reading God's word or just some quiet and purposeful meditation, God will begin to produce all these kinds of fruit in your life, whether it be love. And I like to put it as love, which can give you joy. And love, a connection, gives you joy, which then maybe allows peace to enter in where it hasn't been there before, because maybe loneliness has been dispelled or something else has happened. There's been a connection which has given you peace. And that peace then, I think, begins to crack that window towards knocking out some of the impatience. When you got peace, you begin to be a little bit more patient with one another. You know, because we can snap in a heartbeat. Think of a child for a moment, I always like to pick on children, but you know, think of a child who at one moment can be, you know, sitting at a desk or sitting at a chair and working on a little project or playing with a toy, and then all of a sudden they can almost be like they're climbing a wall. So it can happen just like that. And you know what? We're that way too. We can lose it in a heartbeat. And so we need some patience. Today's theme, of course, is kindness. To be now, it gets, if we have these first four of this ingredients, the love, joy, peace, and patience begins to now get some more action words. Not that love's not an action word, because love, and I believe in the fruit of the Spirit, is an action, but it can lead to the action of kindness and towards one another, goodness towards one another, faithfulness. You know, we say God is faithful at the beginning of each of our worship service, but that faithfulness is an action. It's an action. So faithfulness is important. And then gentleness and self-control. There's no law against any of these. And man, you maybe are tired of me saying these things, because these seem kind of soft, and I'll use the word squishy, for men to behave this way. Men are supposed to be strong and gallant and boastful and all those things. You know, we come packing whatever, our attitudes, our weapons or whatever against something or some, not just, you know, a gun or something like that. But, you know, we're armed and ready to go. We're locked and loaded, so to speak, sometimes, ready to pounce or to shoot off. Or we don't have to be that way. In fact, I believe it's a more joyful life to have some peace and patience and kindness and joy in all things that we have, and gentleness towards one another. Let's go. So I got to give you this one this morning. I give this kind of in jest and funny, because you asked Teresa when the last time she got a Valentine. It might have been when we dated, which has been a year or two ago. But you know, I talked about us men sometimes. I'll give a big Valentine for my wife. Me bad at words, but me sometimes get lucky and string a few good ones together. That's kind of the way we are sometimes. And that's where kindness can start, with beginning to string a few good words together, a little encouragement for somebody, a little hope for somebody to help them with their day. And be kind to a person on the corner that that you just saw or met. And, you know, we see persons on the corner. I've got, in fact, a little joke about that, because we do see people standing on the corner asking for help at times. And I saw this little story about a woman was standing at the bus stop, and she encountered a man that was standing there asking for money. So she went over to him, and she showed compassion. She showed kindness to him, and she was convicted of doing that. So she walked over and handed the man a $10 bill. But she also wanted to offer some encouragement, not just to give him the money and walk away. And she said, she whispered in his ear, never despair. Never despair. The next day, she's at the same bus stop waiting for a bus and sees the man. He comes walking over to her. And he hands her a $100 bill. And she said, you know, kind of like, what's this all about? The man said, well, I'll tell you what. So I want to thank you for the tip. So I took that $10. I went to the racetrack yesterday, and I put $10 on the horse called Never Despair, and it paid off 100-1. So here's your return for that investment that you made in me yesterday. And never despair was a good thing for him. Now, I know it doesn't work that way in our life. We don't get paid off. And I've never been before you to say there's a prosperity gospel, that if you do this, God will return 1,000-fold in your life financially or in some way. But I do believe God is blessed when we bless another person, when we're kind to one another. You never know how your kindness might pay off in the long run towards somebody else. Kindness comes from a Greek word called Chrestotes. I've never been good with pronouncing some of these Greek words, but it means this. It means having tender and sincere concern. Now, men, you might choose another word. Having real might be better for you, or some of you more hard of heart. Real concern for somebody. You know, targeted concern for somebody else. And I think we've all had that. And or it can have just have a nurturing spirit. You see somebody that's struggling in some way, and you want to coach them or help them along. You know, Paul, along his journey, had a nurturing spirit with Timothy to help him on his journey and kind of be his replacement when Paul was ready to go home to be with the Lord. Also, we have to get in touch with our sensitive side to the needs of others. We can't just be, you know, thinking about, well, it should be like this, or you don't know that person's circumstances, why that man was on the corner and needed $10 for whatever. You don't know what circumstances they have been under. So it's just sometimes just offering a kindness of sorts. Why? Because it begins here. It begins with God. Kindness is from the hand of God from the very beginning. From the very beginning, God has been kind to us. So we then be kind to one another. Be kind, be compassionate to one another. You know, the best thing that God does for us is, because we are sinners, we stand in need of forgiveness to restore the right relationship between God and us. And when we get that, then what are we supposed to do with it? We're supposed to begin living in Christ, and for us to each offer forgiveness to one another because God forgave us. Is that a good reason? I think it is. I know it is. I assure you that it is. If we are forgiven, we should be ready, willing, and able to forgive one another. Kindness doesn't begin with me. It begins with God and begins then with the Holy Spirit to prod me or push me into that. Today we have propensity, I believe, to be anything but kind to one another. We're more quickly ready to tear one another apart or offer criticism than we are kind. Some people call it critical thinking sometimes. You know, we're critical of something because we want to get to the root of the problem. That maybe is a little bit different than being critical of someone's nature, but we shouldn't be about tearing everything down first. Might look for the silver lining or the good part of something before we go on. Now, it also, there's a reason for it. I mentioned this a while ago. I don't believe in paybacks for what we have done to enable us to often get riches in this lifetime. But there is one. So much of the fruit of the Spirit has originated for me in the Sermon on the Mount. And so when I was working on this, it was, now what part of the Sermon on the Mount really resonates with being kind? What's God said about this from the very beginning? And I want to look to the words from Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount, which is still and will be the greatest sermon ever preached. And Jesus said, when he began it with what we call the Beatitudes, where he wanted to settle us, humble us, and in some ways put us in our place, but to remind us that God is, you know, the author, the perfecter, the right one in all things. And he said, blessed are you who are merciful. Blessed are you who are kind to one another. For you shall receive mercy. You'll get my kindness. I promise you that. It might not be the kindness that you are seeking from the world, and I'm sorry if that doesn't happen. Oftentimes it doesn't, but it doesn't always. There's not a guarantee. But you will receive mercy from God. Be kind to one another. Be merciful to one another. Because the Lord, He is the righteous. He is righteous in all His ways and kind in all His deeds, as I read you that psalm in the very beginning. And it starts with the Lord in all things. He is a model for kindness. He is the true kindness. See, that's why He was willing to take on the cross for each of us, to go there to die and atone for my sins and my sins alone. Let's look at Titus. A seldom used book, seldom used, I know, by me and Scripture, but it's got some great words, some great advice in it. Let me read you these from Titus 3, verses 4 to 7. It's again a model for us. But when the kindness and love of God, our Savior, appeared, He saved us. Now, there's where I want to offer you that salvation, that saving grace from Jesus. Think for a moment. Do you need that? Have you accepted that? Have you received the saving grace of Jesus Christ? That kindness, the truth, the light, the way, the pathway now to live. He saved us. Not because we had been so good and deserved it or earned it. No, the righteous things that we had done. No, because He is kind. He is merciful in all things. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. See, we keep getting this wrong, I believe, all too often. We think we have to have all the answers, or that we have all the answers. It's the Holy Spirit. You've been renewed by it when you receive Jesus. You get so much more than you can ever imagine when you accept Jesus in your life and your heart. You get all of God, whom He poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by His grace, we might become heirs, having the hope and faith and journey of eternal life ahead of us. Don't have the wrong perception of God. Don't have the perception of God that He's heavy-handed, that He's far away, that He only cares about certain people. You know, I preached about patience last week, and, you know, so I believe it says in Scripture, I believe it was in James, I think I read this, that, you know, our persecutions, the persecutions that we even have in this life, the opposite of some of the good things we think when we attain God, that can bring us patience. Maybe for you, nobody's ever been kind to you. Or maybe it's been so long since you felt the tender mercy and the kindness of someone that you've forgotten what it's like. But I want to remind you today that the Lord is kind. He is righteous. He is real. He is present in all things. And He's a Savior. He's my Savior. He's my Lord. Ephesians 4. I know I'm giving you a lot of Scriptures, but the Scripture backs up the fruit of the Spirit that we should be living out through the Holy Spirit in us. So here's a way to be kind. It says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. Sometimes you have to be in tune with what their needs. You have to allow yourself to be in tune with somebody's needs, and that's where I know I have fallen short so many times. I rush on to the next assignment or the next point and miss some of the little details. So if you build others up, that it may benefit those who listen, you might see some realness out of it. So don't let any unwholesome talk, you know, our tongue is a terrible thing to get unleashed. You remember the scripture tells us it should even be bridled sometimes. It needs to be held back. We need to bite our lip once in a while and not say those things. I wish sometimes I could take what I've said and, you know, wipe it out before I even said it. And it says then, because you grieve the Holy Spirit of God when we do that. Remember, Holy Spirit's right here. He knows what you're up to, knows what you're doing. He's within the entirety of who you are. So whenever you do that, God, yeah, you grieve God. We grieve God. Imagine that. God grieves when we act that way. He doesn't cut us off. He doesn't suddenly say, you're not in my kingdom. You're not my child anymore. I mean, you wouldn't do that to a small child when they grieve you, when they backtalk you or sass you or don't do what you tell them to. You don't just suddenly kick them out the door. No. And sometimes we're like those small children, and God doesn't boot us down the road. He doesn't do that. I assure you that. But we do grieve him. Because he goes on to say, you're sealed to the day of redemption. That's what it's telling me right there, whom you are sealed to the day of redemption. You are God's child. You still have your place with him. So, here's what to do. Verse 31 kind of gives us a summary. Get rid of the bitterness, the rage, the anger, the brawling, the slander, and the forms of malice. And what am I telling you this morning to put in its place? Kindness. 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 Someone once said, kindness is a language the dumb can speak, the dumb can speak and the deaf can hear. The dumb can speak and the deaf can hear. It's a different language. It's not a language spoken that much. William Barclay said, more people have been brought into the church by the kindness of real Christian love than by the theological arguments in the world. I assure you, more people are going to come to this church in McCutchanville, Indiana, because of your kindness towards them or your mercy shown towards them than any sermon that I'm going to stand up here and preach, because they're not going to stand, they're probably not, you know, they're not going to have been here anyway. It's us being out in the world, exemplifying Christ towards one another, that draws people. And that's still God at work, still the Holy Spirit pulling them in. John Wesley, and I'm going to give you a couple quotes before I close. So let's get it back to the earthly realm of what some of the important people that I model in my life have said. John Wesley said, just be about it. The Nike slogan would be, just do it in this place. Some might say, go for it. I think many would say, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But John Wesley put it this way, do all the good you can by all the means you can and all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can. Kindness. Could I apply that one to goodness next week as well? He also, let's go back again, he says, I think I'm getting ahead of myself here. There's that one. And then this one says, let your words be the genuine picture of your heart. Let your words be the genuine. Goes back to that passage in, I believe it was Ephesians, let no unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. Let your words be the genuine picture of your heart. Mother Teresa. Kind words can be short and easy to speak, but their echoes are truly endless. Don't have to give any. You don't have to tell them about your life first to prove yourself. Just offer something that is kind. Back to Wesley. All worldly joys are less than that one joy of doing kindness. All worldly joys are less. So, you know, whatever is, you know, this past week we had basketball games canceled. We had baseball games canceled. We had chatter and talk and everything going on around conventions and about everything else. Those are worldly things. One joy that that Christians can still be about that won't ever fail is doing kindness to one another. Now back to Mother Teresa. Yeah, I'm going back and forth because they're rich in their living. Three things in human life are important. The first is to be kind. The second is to be kind. The third is to be kind. And I think we could say right on down the list. Think for a moment when someone's been kind to you. How'd you feel? How'd it make you feel? Did someone step into your life just at the right time when you needed it most? When you might have been truly at your lowest and they offered you some type of encouragement or kindness. Maybe it was at a church. Maybe it was at a camp. Maybe it was just on the street. Maybe it was at work. I go back and think about my sixth grade teacher, Mrs. Sanders. Never said much. I don't think I've ever used her name in a sermon, but I was thinking of who in my early years, outside of my parents, my grandparents that were, I got there. I had been a good student in my first 5 years at class, but she came to me right after, I think it was the first day or so I was in her class, and she said, I want the best out of you this year, and you can give it to me. And you know, I never worked so hard in my life in that year because she offered a kindness to me. I think it changed away my study habits and everything for the rest of my educational career just because of one little kindness that she did for me at that time. Kindness is what somebody in band, yes, I was in band for a short time. I think it was my it was later than that. And I don't know, whatever year it was, I sat beside this and I mentioned that I would like to possibly date Teresa. And this person said, well, I know her. I could call her and set something up. Kindness. It's lasted a lifetime for us. How I got my first employment job was through my high school basketball coach. I just graduated from high school and needed a job to help pay for my education when I was going to start at University of Evansville. He called me up and said, hey, I heard there's a job at the Coca-Cola bottling plant in Jasper. You interested? Thought you might be. I told him. I gave him your name. I got a job there. My first real job, I worked at for 24 years at Kimball. A good word of kindness was put in for me at that place, and then a call came to me to go up there and talk to him at Kimball. So many helped me with kindness when I went into ministry, offering encouragement, offering help. One of those persons is in our congregation now, Pastor Steve Seitz. Through my journey towards ordination, it was a different journey than anyone else in our conference had ever been on, and kind of had to develop that roadmap on my own, but I was encouraged to do so by many as I went about my educational journey to be ordained. And then a last act I want to mention here of kindness was my dear friend George Purnell, who lives just down Green River Road and brought me to McCutchanville. Called me one day and said, hey, you interested in this? I think you'd be a good fit for those folks out there. And it's been a good journey. And George, I believe, George was thinking about you all and thinking about me and putting us together. And that's kindness. Just some examples, kindness. Just do those things and you'll see results. You'll be blessed in mercy. Lastly, I think this is the last one I'm going to show you about kindness from my favorite person in history, and that's Abraham Lincoln. Kindness is the only service that will stand the storm of life and not wash out. Think about the storms of this last week and how much kindness is going to have to be built in to help those folks recover. It will wear well and will be well remembered long after the prism of politeness or the complexion of courtesy has faded away. Yeah, we can be polite, we can be courteous without truly being generous and kind. We don't have to be seen as grumpy people. Grumpy old people, grumpy young people, grumpy any people. It's a gift. Kindness, last thing I'll say about it, kindness is a gift that you can give someone in your life, someone that you come in contact, someone you might even be going to meet today or tomorrow that you've never met before. It's a gift. But what gift have you been given? Been given the gift of grace and salvation by God Himself. You've received the greatest gift of all. Can you offer a small gift to someone else? Because I believe that I feel the immense gratitude and thanksgiving for the gift of salvation that my Lord has given to me, and I feel like I need to be an instrument of that towards one another. And all these fruit of the Spirit is something I've got to do better. Proverbs 11:17, those who are kind benefit themselves. Those who are kind, it will be a benefit to yourself and to others, I'll add that. But being cruel brings ruin on themselves. In conclusion, Ralph Waldo Emerson said, a mouthful, you can never do a kindness too soon, for you never know how soon it will be too late. Be kind, friends. Let's pray. May the Lord, who has been kind to you, who loves you, cares for you, and given you everything, may He bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face toward you and give you His peace. Amen. See you in person next week. God bless.